All I wanted was to try out NetBSD in a Macintosh LC from the early 90s. Before I could even think about NetBSD, or even installing System 7.5 as the bare minimum, I found myself once more fighting through a heap of bad capacitors and a hard drive that didn't want to spin up, spin down, or spin at all. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. It's in decent shape, no major signs of wear, but I've had this Macintosh LC II for at least 2 years without finding time to tinker with it, until today.
By the way, for those wondering, LC doesn't mean lots of capacitors, though this episode might have you thinking that. It actually stands for low cost.
Released in 1992, it came with a 16 MHz Motorola 68030 CPU with hard drives between 40 and 80 MB and up to 10 MB of RAM, but it was still stuck with a slow 16-bit system bus despite the 32-bit CPU. Kind of like Intel 386SX, a cost-reduced version of the 386DX with a 16-bit data bus as opposed to the DX's 32-bit bus. It was Apple's budget-friendly Mac for schools, sold as the LC2, and homes, sold under the Performa 400 designation, starting from $1,180. Unfortunately, the RAM was missing from this machine. And while I did have plenty of PS2-style RAM, which works perfectly for this later LC3-based Performa 450, I simply didn't have high-capacity SIMs for this LC2. And that's definitely going to be a problem, as we're about to see in the follow-up episode on NetBSD, which recommends having 8 MB of RAM as a minimum. But even with some SIMs plugged in, I have a problem with this LC2. Even though it shows some signs of life, we won't hear the Apple signature chime and the machine will just sit there doing nothing. No question, it's capacitors plague again, something these old Macintosh machines are notoriously prone to.
See? Told you, Apple skimped on those capacitors. Low cost, remember?
So I was pulling out the logic board, removing all caps and giving it a good level of cleaning before putting new replacements in. As I didn't stock matching SMD caps, I just used radial caps instead. These will totally do it. Don't forget to reseat the NVRAM battery, as neither the original Macintosh LC nor the LC2 will boot without it. And keep in mind to replace the battery anyway, especially if it still is the original battery, as those may leak as well and destroy the logic board. Yes, there it is, the Macintosh chime, and the machine is back to life again. But as mentioned before, the LC2 wasn't a great candidate for my upcoming NetBSD experience, mainly because I didn't have enough SIMs on hand. Fair enough, the LC2 can live on as a classic System 7 exhibit. Big thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. If you're working on an electronics project, PCBWay is a fantastic choice for high quality PCB production and full turnkey assembly, offering fast turnaround times and professional manufacturing, just like this excellent drive adapter they produced for my previous IBM P70 restoration project. Check them out at PCBWay.com and get started on your next project today. The Performa 450 though, otherwise known as the LC3, is a better fit. As noted earlier, this one accepts standard PS2 style SIMs. But the first one I tried... yeah. This sound reminded me so much of an actual school bell from my youth, right here in Switzerland. But that wasn't the only sound coming from this machine. Check this out. I guess you agree with me, this doesn't sound healthy, does it? Although it would eventually go away, one can still hear how the hard drive seems to temporarily spin down and up again. There's definitely something odd going on here. Also, the fact this machine wouldn't boot up from the hard drive is proof, and even the SCHD setup utility would object for not finding a hard drive. But first again, I would also go for recapping the logic board first, as this high-pitched whining eventually came back. Pay special attention to this capacitor on the lower right, just beneath the power plug. As noted here, the polarity is reversed, obviously by accident, as Apple made a mistake with the printed silk screen for the LC3 series. So in replacing those capacitors, put that one, and really only that one, in reverse position. While you can remove the SMD caps with a soldering iron, I'd rather recommend using a heat gun instead. And don't forget to apply flux. Alright, that's real progress here, no more whining noise. But still, the hard drive won't be detected. But since Apple's SCHD setup program is not providing lots of detail, I used Lido, which was a lot more talkative. Now, apparently those old quantum drives seem to be prone to caps failure as well. That said, checking back at the drive electronics, it becomes obvious those two capacitors at C110 and C112 have leaked. Once removed, I was cleaning away the leaked goo using some baking soda and vinegar. Luckily, the traces look still okay, so there was still hope. However, swapping the caps and hoping for the best still didn't help to revive that disk. Most likely as those two caps at C111 and C109 were likely destroyed by the leaked capacitor fluid. I'll order some spares to give it another shot. Maybe this drive can still be saved, along with the other Apple branded quantum drives I had here. They all expose the same visible corrosion defects from capacitor leakage. But even if I can revive them, those 40 to 230 megabyte drives are really scraping the bottom when it comes to NetBSD space requirements. So I swapped in this 2 GB Seagate drive and again fired up Lido, which properly detected the drive this time and let me partition it. We'll be looking at this in more detail again in my upcoming NetBSD episode. For today, it shall be enough to say that I created a smaller 350 MB Macintosh partition for installing System 7.5 as a foundation for my next steps. What about you? Beyond the usual capacitors plague, what have you encountered in Macintosh repairs? Broken ROMs, flaky power supplies, or something else that really tested your patience? Drop your stories in the comments, I'd love to hear about your experiences. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday. Next on the Vintage Collector. Running NetBSD or any Unix-like system doesn't really make sense without networking. So I grabbed a Farallon Ethermac adapter. Sure, I could transfer 200 MB of NetBSD install files via floppy disks, but never in my life would I actually try that. But wow, this is the first time I'm setting up networking on a classic Macintosh and actually getting it online.